Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the Philippines. The Lord just had given me a specific Bible verse, and I really wanted to preach it, but I just don't have the leading of the Lord to preach it, but to talk about it real quick. And it's basically this. I already remade this video a couple of times. I tried to make it. This wasn't right in my spirit. The Lord is kind of have a, what's the right word? Kind of a heaviness about the word. But it's positive for Christians, and it's from Acts chapter 17, verse 30. And it basically says, but now, since the time of Christ, the gospel, God calls all men, now commandeth all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness by that man, Paul's talking about Jesus, whom he hath ordained, whereof he hath given assurance unto all men in that he has raised him from the dead. God calls all men everywhere to repent. Now, I keep remaking this video because, look, I've got two groups basically that you're dealing with on YouTube that people are getting confused by. And the number one question I get about salvation. I got the greasy gracers, people who think that you can just mentally assent, they call it, have mental assent that, yeah, Jesus is Christ. Jesus down the cross, that's it. And then they don't need to repent. They don't need to do anything. They can live in sin, just like they did the day before, and they're going to heaven. Then there's the other group who believe you have to follow the law. You have to be perfect. You have to be without sin. And no one is, we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, Romans 3:23. So no one is perfect. So here's the dilemma, and this is what I, you know, the number one thing that I deal with, and that's why God put me on YouTube ultimately. It's not about the orphans and all that, which is a huge part of the ministry, and feeding the 300 to 500 kids that we feed every week, and all of these other things. It's all about Jesus. It's all about the gospel. It's all about getting people saved, even the orphans and the children. It's to get them saved. If the Lord were to tarry for 30 more years, those orphans would be future pastors and church leaders. I mean, that's what it's all about. It's all about advancing the kingdom of Jesus Christ, building his kingdom, not my own, not our own kingdom, but the kingdom of the Lord. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I've talked about this before. Let me say this. The Lord is leading me to tell you that it's time to repent. Okay. John the Baptist came with a baptism unto repentance, the Bible tells us. It's not New Testament, it's Old Testament. Old Testament saints to get baptized to prepare the way, to get themselves prepared, spiritually prepared, to receive the Messiah. Because he was coming. That's what John the Baptist baptism is all about. It's not the same as the baptism of what we do. In the New Testament, the baptism in the Old Testament of John the Baptist is a baptism unto repentance. Now, we in the New Testament, that's not our baptism. Our baptism, okay, is really a baptism to identify with Christ, to be buried with Christ and raised with him again. That's the New Testament. Now, this is what I was talking about in the video that I'm redoing. Let me just go through it as quickly as I can. In Hebrews, it tells us, which is common sense. Have you ever heard of when somebody dies, like before you die, somebody you make a will? The last will and testament of so-and-so. Okay, I can write a will today, but like say I leave everything to my wife. My wife can't go take that will and say, well, all of Patrick's clothes are mine now. I'm going to go give them away to my brother. You know, my brothers need some clothes. I'm going to go give them away here because Patrick willed them to me. No, they're still mine. That will, I could rewrite that will tomorrow. I could tear up that will and write another will every day. I could write 100 different wills, you know, and of course you're supposed to have one at a time. You know, if you had more than one, it would throw it into, you know, to be contested. Anyway, that will, as Hebrews tells us, which we all know, we have some sense, that a will does not become in effect. The last will and testament does not come into effect until it is necessary, as Hebrews says, to the death of the testator. In other words, the one who made the will needs to die. And then the will becomes in effect. So the New Testament, it's called the Testament of Jesus Christ. It's like a will, last will and testament. It is a book that became in effect. The covenant of the New Testament came into effect at the death of Christ. So when we read in the New Testament, I've said this a long time ago, about 2 years on a video, and some people say, well, I feel like when I'm reading the beginning of the Gospels, it's the New Testament because when I open my book, it's in the New Testament, in the beginning of the New Testament. But listen to what I'm saying. Until Jesus died, as Hebrews, I'm saying what the book of Hebrews says, and what we know that we practice today in this world, until you die, the testament is not into effect. The covenant of the New Testament came into effect with the death of Christ. You couldn't get saved till he died. Until he died and rose again. That's the gospel. That couldn't happen until he was crucified. We're saved through his crucifixion. Now those who believed on Christ before, and they believed on him, and then he was died and buried, and then they heard about it. Okay, he was crucified, he died and resurrected, like the apostles. They were saved after they found out, yeah, he resurrected. They saw him, or they heard it from the apostles if they didn't see him. Other people, even people he had met before, who believed on him, they got saved. So when you're reading the beginning of the Gospels, you're actually still reading the Old Testament. Technically, Jesus lived on this earth under the law. He practiced the law. He went to the synagogue on the Sabbath, which was his custom, it says. Now people will say, I don't want to even get into that teaching. Oh, Jesus did that, so that's what we should do. Jesus lived under the law. Jesus wasn't living as a man in the New Testament. We got the New Testament because he died. He was crucified, and that's what made the New Testament, his death, burial, and resurrection. Okay, so John's baptism was for the nation of Israel. As Jesus said, I didn't come for the Gentiles. I came for the Israelites. And then he said that first must be rejected by this generation. Then the Gentiles can come to the Lord. After Israel rejected their Messiah, they crucified him, he resurrected, they still rejected him, boom. Then the Gentiles were able to come into the kingdom. And then after one generation, 40 years, the temple was destroyed. AD 70, all that was destroyed. God did away with their abomination of sacrifices that was an abomination to the blood of Christ. All those sacrifices had already become null and void, covered by the blood of Jesus at the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Animal sacrifice is no longer necessary with the blood of Christ, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. So, brothers and sisters, what I'm trying to get to you is, we're preparing the way for the Messiah to come back. Now, I'm not saying, oh, you need to go get rebaptized in a baptism type of John the Baptist. That's what they did as part of their tradition and part of the Old Testament and their traditions out of the Old Testament that, unlike us in the New Testament, were buried, identifying with Christ in burial and resurrection, becoming, you know, the old man is dead, the new, behold, you know, the new man. We become a new creature in Christ. In the Old Testament, as I said, under John the Baptist, as Jesus said, let me just add some more Bible verses here to lock this up with all those, you know, crazy people on YouTube who think they're preachers and they're not. Jesus said, there was no greater prophet in the whole Old Testament but John the Baptist. But I tell you the truth, that he who is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than John the Baptist. Now, it's New Testament. He said that in Matthew. So Jesus is saying that, you know, if you're a born-again Christian in the New Testament, you're greater than the greatest prophet in the Old Testament. No, there was no greater prophet in the Old Testament than John the Baptist, Jesus said. So there he was. He's the Old Testament prophet. Out of the words of Christ. Out of the mouth of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Anyhow, what I'm saying is the Lord is dropping on me. We need to repent, brothers and sisters. We need to consecrate ourselves unto the Lord. Let me say this. This is what I'm trying to say. And I redid this video because I just wanted to pray about it and reconfirm, you know, theologically. Because the Bible tells us if you're a teacher, you have to give an account to the Lord for what you teach. So I just prayed about it and double-checked in my spirit what the Lord had showed me. Jesus dictated seven letters to the Apostle John in the Revelation, Book of Revelation, chapters 2 and 3. And one of those churches, the Church of Philadelphia, one of those churches, Jesus told them this. Revelation chapter 3, verse 10. Jesus said, because thou hast kept the word of my patience, I will keep thee from the hour of temptation which shall come upon all the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly, hold fast what thou hast, that no man take it thy crown. He that overcometh, and he says that to all the churches, he that overcometh, he makes promises to them. Okay, what I'm trying to tell you is standard theology of standard theology that people have been doing for the last couple hundred years, particularly from the Baptist background, leading into your modern-day Assemblies of God and Church of God and all that. It's been assumed, or it's been said or unsaid, that if you're saved, you're going into rapture. So what I'm trying to tell you, and the Lord has been leading me on this, I used to be of the opinion that if you were saved, you were going into rapture. But the Lord himself has transform my opinion on this doctrine through dreams, visions, through Bible verses and all that. The Lord has led me to see the Bible verses to point that being saved does not guarantee you the blessed hope of the rapture. What guarantee, you know, being saved means, oh, when you go die, you're going to be in heaven. That's what being saved means, being born again. That, you know, Jesus said, no one man can enter the kingdom of heaven except he be born again. John 3:3. And John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believe in him will not perish but have everlasting life. That's not, the rapture is a totally different event. That is the blessed hope, and it's a special blessing, and it's not for all. That's what I'm trying to tell you. That's what the Lord is leading me and showing me through the text, particularly. You know, that's where, you know, we got to divide the word. Either, unless people have some special righteousness, they're not saved, which is totally contradiction of what all the Bible says. Or there's a special righteousness required to be raptured. So we have to pray about that and see which is true. So we have to look at the Bible as a whole. The whole message of the Bible, the best way to sum it up is Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9. It says, by grace are you saved through faith, not of your own. It's a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. But Jesus said, and this is where you get all these people that are saying, you know, they you know, about holiness and stuff. Jesus said in Luke chapter 21, when he starts talking about this, Luke 17, Mark 13, Matthew 24, Luke 17, and Luke 21. That's your four main chapters talking where Jesus talked about the end times, tribulation, and all that, the second coming. And he said that at the end of his talking about the tribulation, he said, watch therefore, and pray ye always that ye be counted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. To escape these things. Revelation 3:10. Because you have patiently kept my word. That's the modern way of saying it. Because you have patiently kept my word, I will keep you out of. The Greek word is ek, which means out of, not through, not like what these people that don't believe in the rapture say. Let me tell you something. They'll use this example. There's a brother I know. The guy, if you guys have been watching my videos, you know I helped start several churches. They were all Filipino. One of them was all black people but me. Okay, and then my prayer partner was a black guy, Pastor Gully. I said his last name, Pastor Gully. And, you know, he was saying he didn't really believe in the rapture anymore. And he was telling me, I've had lots of preachers tell me that. They don't believe in the rapture anymore. And anyway, so these people who I know, who I pray with, so I respect their opinion. And I don't just start arguing with them. I say, well, I pray about it. And I sincerely seek God and pray. All the different questions that different pastors gave me, why they didn't believe in the rapture, I prayed about it. And I was open to change my position that there was no pre-trib rapture. And the Lord showed me clearly, like he said, as an example, this brother, the pastor I mentioned, he said that, well, just as the Israelites were kept in the land of Goshen during the time of the judgment on Egypt, so the church will be kept. That's a type of the church, and the church was kept through the tribulation, and Egypt was hit by they weren't taken out of Egypt. They stayed there in the land of Goshen and were protected. So I said, okay. So I prayed about it, and the Lord spoke to me when I prayed about it that night and said, no, that's a type of Israel. Israel himself, it's what's going to happen to Israel during the tribulation. Israel is a type of itself. Israel will be kept through the tribulation in Petra during the second half of the tribulation, during those all the most terrible judgments, the trumpets and the vials. Israel will be there in Petra, or Bozrah, it's called in the Bible, and protected by God in the second half of the tribulation. The church will not be here. It's this ek in the Revelation 3:10, the Greek word out of. Jesus says in Luke 21:36, watch, all pray always that you be counted worthy to escape these things and stand before the Son of Man. So you would say, well, you know, we're the righteousness of Christ, we're worthy because of Christ. See, so that's when you're talking salvation and to be kept out of something. Two different things. So in the past, even my own mind, I just, you know, it's like people commingle those two things as if they're one and the same, but it's not. It's not the same. Only those, I'm convinced that the Lord is telling me to say this, and I'm convinced that not just it's some private interpretation or you know, extra biblical statements I'm making. These are based on Bible verses that the Lord has quickened in my heart. This is very serious. This is not a joking matter. If you don't believe this, this is something you need to look at the Bible verses sincerely and honestly and pray about it. That's the problem, is the Bible says when you rebuke a fool, you receive his wrath. If you rebuke a wise man, he'll take it to heart. You know, from Proverbs, and that's a true statement. When people tell me some theological stuff, especially a preacher, you know, someone who I know and respect as a man of God or a woman of God, and they tell me, hey, you know, this is what the Bible says, and I think you're teaching this, and this is what it says. Not some, you know, clown fly by night on YouTube that's been saved for 2 weeks and then trying to, you know, it's just like, you know, watching the doctors on TV. Then the next day you're at your doctor's office, you know, interrupting brain surgery and trying to take over. I mean, that's 90% of the people that I deal with are like that. Okay, and that's why I'm not entertaining them. But people who are mature Christians, and particularly pastors and elders and deacons and stuff like that, has been in the Lord for years. And they would message me and say, Brother Patrick, have you considered this doctrine? And then they tell it to me in love. And when I listen to them, I pray about it. I earnestly take it to heart and earnestly consider that I'm wrong or not. We should all be that way. But as I said, 90% of the people that you run into just got saved last week, and now suddenly they're some kind of high theologian. And that's, you know, pride goes before a fall, a haughty spirit before destruction, the Bible says. And it's definitely true. That's why the Bible says that a new convert shouldn't be an elder, shouldn't be a leader, because, you know, Satan will get them in pride. And that's exactly what we see all the time. That's what I see all the time on YouTube. Anyway, brothers and sisters, and in the ministry, in the States too, whatever. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I ask you to earnestly pray about this. And the word that the Lord gave me was that text, a specific Bible text. He gave me the Bible book and verse. And when I'm not one of those people. I don't flip my Bible open and look for stuff. Let me say that. I never do that. Okay? And this is what happened to me. The Lord, and while I was praying, and I saw the cover of this book with my eyes closed. And I was like, okay, the Lord wants me to look something in the Bible. I said, what, Lord? He said, get the book. I got it. And then the Lord spoke to me when I picked it up. He said, Acts 17:30. I opened the book, opened right to the page, and my thumb was on the 30th verse. Right to Acts 17, and my thumb was on the 30th verse. I've never had that happen before, and like I said, I'm not one of these people that flip the Bible up and see what the Lord showed me. I never do that. Just a confirmation from the Lord. God calls all men everywhere to repent. Repentance of dedication, sanctification, kind of like what John the Baptist was doing, but you don't have to, I'm not talking about the, you know, a ceremony of baptism. That was symbolic of they were dedicating themselves to God for the preparation of receiving the Messiah. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. That's what they were doing. We need to prepare the way of the second coming. We need to prepare the way for the rapture. I need to teach more on this. The Lord is just opening this up to me. I never thought about this before ever. And the Lord just spoke to me about it tonight. It's just coming to me. You know, I usually just flow with it. I need to meditate on this and lay this out in a better video later on and preach it for the non-believers and stuff. People need to repent. I'm talking about it's time to get rid of the luggage, get the skeletons out of the closet. It's time to get right with God. It's time to get real with God. I mentioned that before, and it's true. Lots of the people I met with, that, you know, they're seeking God, but not all the way. They're not all in. They're not all in. You got to get all in. You know, this rapture is coming up on us fast, and that's really because I said to the Lord, you know, the Lord was like telling me just in a calm voice, it's time for the rapture. It, you know, and I know I've made videos about that. People making videos about it. I don't know the date or the hour, but the Lord has just calmly told me it's time. It's time for the rapture. It's now. The time is upon us. It's time to get real with God. Time to stop playing. Repent. Repent. Repent means to, they say, those experts say, that in the Greek, repent means to change your mind. And in the Hebrew, it means to change your actions. So, for Greek, you know, you change your way of thinking. And in Hebrew, you actually change what you're doing. But repent does not mean just only saying, I'm sorry. It means to change your ways, to change your ways, to stop doing it. Now, as we know, no one's perfect. We continue to have our bad habits, but we need to continue to repent. 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. That was written to the church. 1 John 1:9, not written to the world, to the church. Those of us who are in Christ, and I know we talk about repentance and all that for the non-believers, I know that. I need to make a video for them, kind of with the same message, but focusing on salvation in Christ. I'm telling Christians, You've got to be rapture ready. And it's including myself. You know, we have got to continually press in to the Lord. There's two types of sanctification: positive sanctification, negative sanctification. What do I mean? Negative is getting away from the world, fleeing from sin, getting away from sin. Most people look at that. They try to, oh, I'm going to stop smoking. But the positive sanctification is running to the Lord, drawing close to the Lord. He'll draw close to you, the Bible says. The Lord says that. God, draw close to me, I'll draw close to you. Call upon me, and I'll answer you, and show you great and mighty things that you know not. Jeremiah 33:3. God's phone number, Jeremiah 33:3. Call upon me, and I'll answer you, and show you great and mighty things that you know not. Psalm 24. Who shall ascend to the mountain, you know, the mountain of the Lord, the hill of the Lord? Him with clean hands and a pure heart, who has not lifted himself up to vanity. These are the things we're talking about, getting close to God. We're not talking about, okay, I'm saved. You know, I got my bus ticket, and hey, forget about it. I'm just doing whatever I'll do in my own will. You know, and there's debates about whether you can lose your salvation. Once saved, always saved, all this different stuff. If you're truly following the Lord, you're not saying, what do I got to do to get by? You're not saying, you know, that whole attitude, the whole idea, the whole mindset is the opposite of God. It's the flesh. People walking after the flesh, like the video I just loaded that the Lord gave me, you can choose to walk according to the flesh or walk according to the Spirit. I got to preach this. I got to make a new video and preach this thing. I'm just trying to lay out the theology of those who normally watch my videos, hear where I'm coming from. Salvation and the rapture are two different things. Being saved doesn't guarantee you to go in the rapture. Seven churches written to in Revelation 2 and 3, only one church is promised by the Lord. Because you have patiently kept my word, is the modern English, because you have kept the word of my patience, King James, I will keep you out of the hour of temptation that will come upon all of mankind. Only one church. Why? Because they kept the word of his patience. They patiently kept his word. That's what? They walked in holiness. It's not, he didn't say that to the other churches. Brothers and sisters, every church that Jesus wrote to besides that, you know, he tells them to repent, therefore, he who overcomes will I, you know, he gives those different rewards to each, he mentions different rewards to each church. They all have symbolic meanings. They all have deeper meanings about the rewards and all this kind of stuff. And I can teach on and on and on about that. But people want to get into all that. Let's don't get into all that. Let's just get this down right, just the basics. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all those things will be added to you. Seek the Lord Jesus Christ while he may be found. Time to repent. Time to come out of the world. But more importantly than focusing on coming out of the world, like I said, most people are trying to come out of the world. Instead of worrying about separating yourself from the world, worry about cleaving to the Lord Jesus Christ. Cleave to the Lord. Hang on to the Lord. Lay hold of eternal life. Grab the hem of his garment as he's passing by. I don't want to start preaching because I've already been on here 23 minutes. But you got to get a hold of Jesus. As they say, there's an old song, the Southern Gospel song. I heard this little old lady, she's not that old, 10 years older than me maybe. This woman, she used to have seizures that I prayed for. The first person I prayed for whom the Lord healed, I fasted 3 days and prayed for her and she was healed. That was in like April or May 2001. This sister, her name is Sandra Danley, as a matter of fact, is her name. Southern gospel singer. She used to sing this song called "He's Still Passing By." I haven't heard anybody sing it but her, because I haven't really been too much in churches out in that area in the mountainous areas of North Carolina. It's called "He's Still Passing By," and the Lord Jesus Christ is still passing by. He's always perpetually passing by. It's like I've preached this before. I'm going to start preaching. You know, there at Jericho, it says that the blind man called out to him and said, "Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy." And the crowd told him, "Be quiet." You know, that's religion for you. I'll be quiet now. Don't be making no noise around here. Don't be making no trouble. Don't trouble at the master. And then he cried even more the loud, "Jesus, thou son of David." When he said, "Thou son of David," he's calling the Messiah. He's acknowledging it. This is the Messiah. "Thou son of David, have mercy." You know, Jesus answered. You know, said, "What is it you want me to do?" Jesus responded. Jesus responded the more he shouted. That's what you need to do. He's still passing by. Call upon his name. You need to be set free. You need to be delivered. You need to be physically healed, mentally healed, spiritually healed, set free in Christ. Call upon his name. Call upon the name of the Lord Jesus. Save me. Just like Peter when he was sinking in the water. He said, "Jesus, save me." And what did, you know, everybody loves to talk about Peter sinking in the water. Oh, you know, Jesus said, "Ye of little faith." What about the fact that nobody got the boat but Peter? And then Peter, even though he made mistakes, when he started sinking, he knew exactly what to do. He wasn't full of pride and arrogance. Like most, that's a whole nother sermon. Thank you, Lord. See, I need to write these things down. Most of you, when you're sinking, you're so full of pride and arrogance, you won't call on the name of the Lord. You'd rather sink than call on the name of the Lord. Maybe you call your friends and ask them what you should do. Peter didn't turn around to the people on the boat. Hey, what should I do? Can you help me out here? Throw me a rope? No. Peter, and the reason why Jesus loved Peter and Jesus used Peter, even though he wasn't perfect, and that's why the Lord uses me. Not that I'm Peter, but I'm saying because I can be humble to the Lord. I'm not ashamed to call on the Lord and say, Lord, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm totally lost. I'm sinking. I need help. Lord, save me. Lord, help me. I'm not afraid to say that. And that's what the Lord's looking for. He gives grace to the humble, but he resists the proud. I am definitely not a perfect person, and I definitely don't know everything. But my secret to my walk with the Lord is, hey, I'm not ashamed to call on the Lord and tell him I don't know what I'm doing, and I need his help right now. Lord, save me, just like Peter did when he was sinking. And I wouldn't compare myself to Peter, but I guess I should since I'm already talking about it. I see 99% of you guys are still sitting back there in the boat. And people are not walking on the water. You know, they're in the boat and criticizing me, criticizing people who are trying to walk on the water. And they themselves are sitting in the boat. Not just me, other people's trying to walk on the water. They're criticizing him instead of getting out on the water. They're not even taking any chance, any risk, walking in any faith. 99% of the people I meet, they're not walking by faith. It's all right here. Their relationship with the Lord, serving the Lord, doing for the Lord, giving, it's all right here. It's all right here. As I've said before, there are people with no money, and I've seen people, and then myself, when I was working and doing the ministry part-time, and I tithed and gave above my tithe offerings and all this kind of stuff, you know, more than 10%. And, you know, so 10% for one person is a penny in the pocket to somebody else. You know, your 10% could be 90% to somebody else. And I see people, and it's a shame. What I've learned is really true, that it is easier for a camel to fit through the eye of a needle than a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. I've seen people with little means giving much, not just in Joshua's ministry. And when I was sitting in the pew with other people, I've seen people with little means giving much, and people with much means giving little. And that's generally true, and that's generally a true statement. Why the Lord himself said, it's easier for a camel to fit through the eye of a needle than a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. You know, they don't want to depart. Just like the rich young ruler, Jesus said, give everything you got away and come follow me. And it says that he went away sad. Money was his God. Not everybody needs to give away everything they have and follow Jesus. You know, we have different things that we need to give away. That's the thing about the Lord. What is it that you need to give away? Whatever you love the most, that's what you need to give away. Lots of people, it's money. That's true. That's absolutely true. Other people, it's other things. It could be pornography. Lots of young men message me. They have trouble with pornography. Different things. People have different things. Whatever is their idol in their heart, what's on the throne of their heart, that's what they need to get rid of. So that's why I'm telling you, the Lord is telling me it's time to repent. God calls all people everywhere to repent. Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Prepare ye the way of the Lord. Make his path straight. It's time for the Lord to come for his church. It's time for you to get real with God. Stop playing on the shallow end of the pool. It's time to repent. It's time to get real. It's time to quit sitting on a bench and watching the videos. It's time to move in action. Move in action. If you're a businessman or a woman, yes, you need to build an orphanage in the Philippines. I will help you do it. If you're called by God to preach, yes, you need to do that, and I will give you advice. I'll come there. Maybe I can preach with you. We can go somewhere and preach together, Lord willing. I'll help you with that. Maybe God called you to be a prayer warrior intercessor. You have questions about that, need help with that? I'll help you do that too. Whatever your calling is from God. That's what I've been trying to tell people. Like in the book that the Lord gave me to write. The link's on the bottom if you want to get one. Rosemary's house is full of them in her garage. We need to get them sold. I think I mentioned that in the last video that I loaded. Sorry about that. I want to get those books out of her garage. Get them out there. Get the message out there. People need to walk. If you're ever going to do anything for God, now is the time to do it. Time is up. Time is over. Now is the time to walk out what God called you to do. Run that race right now. Stop clowning around. Stop playing around. Stop delaying. Stop denying the Lord. the harvest. The Bible says that the Lord deserves the reward of his suffering. When you're denying the Lord the reward of his suffering, when you're not doing what God called you to do, whether it be to donate money to Joshua's ministry to build an orphanage, whether it's buy some of the books that I wrote, the message of repentance and revival, and give them away to people, are you going to yourself are going to go pray for people in the hospital who are sick? Are you going to intercede for Joshua's ministry? Are you going to intercede for other people, whatever God called you to do? Whatever it is, all those different kinds of things. Do that which the Lord God created you to do. Do it now. Stop sitting on your blessed assurance. And I've said this 100 times. Get out and get in the game. Stop trying to be the coach. The Lord is the coach. Get out there and get on the team. Repent. Repent. That means turn from your own ways. Turn from the ways of this world and do God's will in your life. God bless you guys. I ended up preaching a little bit. I got to do a short version of this video for people that are not saved. God bless you guys. I love you guys. I'm just pushing these videos out because the Lord just told me plainly today when he gave me that Bible verse that it's all over with, man. It's over with. The church age is over with. We're just in... I can't set a date. The Lord didn't give me a date. He just told me that the game's over. No time left. If you're ever going to get some rewards in heaven, if you're ever going to, you know, fulfill the destiny that God gave you, now it's time to do it. Please repent and turn to the Lord and follow Jesus. Jesus said, follow me. Follow him wherever he may go. Stop worrying about burying the dead. Let the dead bury the dead. Stop worrying about all these other things and follow Jesus.